it's a dollar a gallon cheaper, people are going to go to that fuel. The fuel works. Look, Formula One racing for two decades was methanol. And by the way, back in the 80s, the Department of Energy said, you know, methanol is cheap, let's require it, let's do a demonstration. They went to California, they got 15,000 cars, it worked great, the people loved it, and then the market in crude oil crashed down to, what, $5 or $6, and they said, what's the point? Crude oil is so cheap, it'll be cheap forever. This has been obvious for a long time, and when you put it out there on the market for people to buy it at a cheaper price, when it really works, the market will... This is one thing that you don't need to subsidize.
John, do the oil companies want cheaper fuels?
You know, the oil companies gave up the retail business a long time ago. They do supply at a wholesale level to the retailers, but the oil companies have concluded they're technology companies. Their best bet is to spend their capital on technologies that go after the raw materials.
Will they embrace or resist methanol?
I've had many conversations with wholesalers and dealers and station owners over this. If they have a product that they can sell, these are retail people. They love to sell, and they just will sell anything that will make them some money at the forecourt. And if it's we put some E85 stations into Chicago where my former company still had a few retail stations left. People didn't like the E85 in Chicago because all that freeway driving, they got a lot less miles per gallon at a higher price.
Right.
What's the point? Fewer miles per gallon at a higher price. If it's a lower price, Americans love a deal. I think the retailers will jump on something that will give them margin that they don't get from other sources.
Frank, a couple of numbers.
Go ahead.
Methanol today, got by at the hardware store, I think is about $1.10 a gallon.
For which?
$1.10 a gallon for methanol.
Methanol.
It's wood alcohol. It's just wood alcohol. You choose to clean things, it's all over the place. If you have to about double the amount in order to have the equivalent amount of energy to gasoline. So say you need 2 gallons to make up for one. You're still just above $2 per gallon of gasoline equivalent, which is a buck or so below where gasoline is now, and certainly below where gasoline is going to be after these developments that have been described for the next year or two or three. So there's a big cost advantage, price advantage.
Secretary.
I very much agree with Jim, but you have to keep in mind, diesel fuel used to be much cheaper than gas. And those of us who have boats, marine diesel was even cheaper because they didn't have taxes on it. Diesel now is more expensive. And if you press the system and say, well, why is it? It's because of distribution costs. You can't use new fuels and think of a price without adding to the price Jim's talking about, the distribution cost. And if you mandate a gas station, tell them you have to do this, they'll pass that cost right on. And when you push the gizmo, it's not going to be at $1.16 a gallon. It's going to be a lot higher.
So then how do you get, and how does plan envision getting that to people?
Where it's so simple it's scary. If you have something that's good or better and it's cheaper, and you just allow the market to obtain. Look, who would have bought a Prius 20 years ago, besides my friend here? But he's got Prius at Volt. He's overdone it. But the point is, once people realized they could buy something like that and that they could really save money and they were daily commuters, it becomes the commuter's choice car.
You know, Frank, 10 days ago today, we commemorated the 10th anniversary of the greatest attack on this country since Pearl Harbor. And I was reflecting on that wouldn't it have been nice if in the wake of that attack, with there's such a spirit of patriotism, what can I do as an American to help reduce this threat, to get back? If we had passed something like a Patriot tax, marginally coming in at a slow ramp rate on a gallon of gasoline, think how much more secure and prosperous we would be today if we had wisely used those dollars. So I think that Norm Augustine is right. We need leadership, and we need leadership that puts ourselves into 2021 or 2025 and looks back at 2011 and says, what did we do then that makes us more secure and more prosperous and keeps our young men and women in uniform out of harm's way in a greatly globalized, highly competitive, more prone to conflict world because of this strategic commodity called oil?
You say we need leadership. I've heard several of you say we need leadership. From where?
From us.
Like Air Force One and Air Force Two. So 747 and 757 can operate on other type of fuel than just avgas. We can make B-52s do it, C-17s do it. These are big airplanes. It starts with the leadership of the country.
I'm a big believer in of the people, by the people, and for the people. You know, after 9/11, we saw a lot of these magnet stickers, the yellow ribbons, support our troops. That's a great spirit. It's a nice thought. But it's not walking the walk. Walking the walk is realizing that every time we stick that gasoline nozzle in our tank, we are somehow fueling the war against our troops that are being killed by petrodollars.
Senator Hart?
People, I think, are ahead of the leadership here. This city is now so frightened by the T word, tax, that you can't even bring it up. But we could do more to achieve the objectives that we've talked about by putting a carbon tax on, or doing what I proposed 30 years ago in legislation, taxing imported oil, which would have returned $1 or 2 trillion to our treasury by now.
Those taxes are.
And people say, you can't do that, the American people won't stand for it. Well, I just give you two personal examples that are somewhat dated, but they're not to compliment myself, but to point out how much smarter the American people are. Jimmy Carter, in 1980, after two oil embargoes, proposed a 10-cent tax on a gallon of gasoline, one time, 10 cents. 11 United States senators voted for it. I was one, and I think I was the only one running for re-election in a conservative Western state, and I was re-elected. 2 years later, having introduced a $10 a barrel tax on imported oil, I undertook a campaign of folly running for president. And I was told, forget about New Hampshire, because every New England state heats its homes with imported oil. I campaigned on that issue and won every New England primary. The American people will listen. And if I overdramatize this about trading the lives of our sons and daughters for Persian Gulf oil, it is to make that point.
You agree, Senator Johnson?
I absolutely agree. You know, this is not pie in the sky. This is absolutely doable. I mean, we've got a product that can be produced cheaper than foreign oil. And why don't we do it?
But if you're talking about a tax, I mean, I remember President Reagan, there was talk in the Reagan administration about putting taxes, a suggestion of a tax on gasoline. There was a suggestion, remember the famous Al Gore BTU tax?
Yeah.
Was going, we can't do these things. Politics smothers this in the crib.
Well, wait a minute. I love this group, and I want to see it succeed. So, Gary, and I love you, but let's don't talk about taxes. Let's talk about methanol cheaper than gasoline, because taxes will scare too many people. Methanol is cheaper than gasoline. Just remember that. And you don't have to have a tax to make it go.
We just heard, though, that diesel was cheaper than gasoline, too, isn't anymore.
Well, these are distribution issues. The fundamentals
stay there.
Really are that with hydrofracturing and natural gas down at $4 a million BTUs, you can make methanol for around $1 a gallon, maybe less.
That's what I want to talk about for a minute.
There are distribution issues and so forth, so Jim and others, but that is the reason that this has gotten such attraction, mm-hmm. using it together with gasoline or ethanol.
John,
give people a choice.
John, Senator, Bud, any of you?
Yes.
Talk a little bit about methanol, where it might come from, the underlying supply and the connection now with these immense natural gas deposits that we have found in this country. Somewhat controversial for the fracking in some places, but nonetheless, massive deposits.
Let me, Frank, go ahead.
I will defer to John. I think that your recurrent question about what does it take for us to do this, we don't have the leadership, but I do think that ultimately Americans like to make a profit, and alternative fuels are going to be a profitable business. And I don't say that because I'm not an investor, but when I go to hedge funds and I'm trying to rally support for these alternative fuels, they say, every one of them, but we get it. This works. Methanol works. Gas to liquids, ethanol, cellulosic, biodiesel, all of them work. All of them are scalable. We get it. And we will invest in it when there are a lot of cars that can burn it. Right now, there is no market. And so that becomes the problem, and that's what unites us here tonight. That if there were 15 million or more automobiles, starting with government, state, federal, local, that's a market. And that will draw the investment in that ramps up the production of these alternative fuels. At the end of the day, it's people, whether Wall Street or Warren Buffett or any other bright investor, will see a profit. And there is one.
I think when you look at the natural gas supply and combine it with the advances in technology, both hydraulic fracking technology and horizontal drilling technology, we have moved in 3 to 4 years into a new, totally new world of supply of energy. The hydraulic fracking can be done in ways that are sustainable and responsible and protect the water and require the management of surface water that you've brought up from below. That's a regulatory matter, and it has to be enforced. But best practices and the following of best practices by responsible operators, I think we will see very few instances of the anecdotes that Gasland tried to portray, and there's going to be a Gasland 2 that comes out, I think, on HBO, taking these anecdotes and turning them into an unreality. Secondly, in the hydraulic or in the horizontal drilling, everybody, I think, is probably familiar with coal veins and coal veins and coal mines that can go on for miles. That's what shale gas is like. You have these geological substrata that go on for miles. When the horizontal drilling first started, maybe 4 years, I mean, it started a long time ago, but in the last 4 years, we've gone from roughly 100 up to 1,000 feet of horizontal pipe up now to about 8,000 to 10,000 feet of horizontal pipe.
And when 2 miles of pipe.
When you frack that, you are letting loose gas molecules in orders of magnitude greater than we have ever produced vertically. So when you do a vertical well, you just don't get but the depth of that shale formation. When you go horizontal, you get the whole banana. And so as a result of that, you have all this gas looking for a market. And a liquid fuel market, because of internal combustion engines, is a huge market.
Jim, sorry, Senator, you want to jump in here?
Well, I was just going to say, don't forget about coal. We're the Saudi Arabia of coal. You can make methanol from coal. And actually, a plant being built in Louisiana to make methanol from actually using pet coke, which is a refinery necessary product of refining, but basically the same thing as coal. They're going to make the methanol, capture the CO2, and use the CO2 for enhanced oil recovery. And you get about 40% of what you originally had in an oil field by enhanced oil recovery using the CO2. Talk about a win-win. I mean, that's not a pipe dream. That's being done in Lake Charles, Louisiana right now. There's another one in Indiana that's basically doing the same thing. This is not a pipe dream. It's workable.
I want to ask Jim Woolsey and then go to the audience for a few questions. And Chairman Greenspan, if you have to leave, you have a...
Yeah, unfortunately,
We'll certainly understand that. If you have any tips for us before you do, we'll take those.
I do, but I've forgotten them.
I see. Jim Woolsey, I know that you have been very outspoken on a number of these things, also cellulosic ethanol. You're very engaged in the whole plug-in process. In terms of the making of methanol, break that down for us for just a minute, and then I'd like to open it up to the audience, questions and observations on the practicality, questions, politics, anything that you may have on this topic.
Well, human beings have been making both grain alcohol and wood alcohol for a long, long time. And methanol is just wood alcohol. It's all over our lives. It's the windshield wiper fluid in your car. You can buy it at the hardware store. We had a big ethanol business in the United States until a few years ago when the price of natural gas skyrocketed and a large number of the methanol plants closed down and started operations in China. But it's not that hard to start back up, and it's not as if there's any technological challenge. It's not as if this country doesn't know how to make methanol with natural gas. We do that just fine. And I think that it would, we have experts in the audience as well as John here on the stage who know a lot more about the chemical process that does it, but it's a pretty simple one. And natural gas is an ideal feedstock for it. You can't drink it. When people say it's poisonous, they mean you can't drink it. The only fuel you can drink is ethanol, because it's 200 proof vodka, basically. I've always said that one good reason to go to ethanol is that tailgate parties are so easy. All you need is a long straw and a lime.
Don't forget the lime.
Other
the
than
lime's
the fact
important.
That you can't drink methanol, it is very safe. It doesn't catch fire easily. It evaporates. If you have a spill, you don't have an ecological problem. It is, except that you can't drink it.
So, Jim, is this the dawn of a new prohibition period?
Well, don't get me started. One of the reasons that we, Henry Ford lost, and we didn't use ethanol to drive cars on, and General Motors won, and they put lead in the tetraethyl lead to get the octane up, instead of using ethanol, was because this all was taking place in the 1920s, and it was in Prohibition. And I don't know if any of you have ever seen the wonderful old Cheech and Chong movie Up in Smoke about the car made out of marijuana. Well, this would have
what
been
kind of movies do you watch?
Oh, lots. In the 1920s.
It was a favorite at the CIA.
Yeah, it was.
It's a training film. Come on.
A training film.
Waterboard him.
But in the 1920s, trying to drive a car on ethanol would have been like trying to drive one on marijuana today. What the hell are you going to do with 200 proof vodka all over the country driving cars in the middle of Prohibition? So we got off onto gasoline and tetraethyl lead. Lead is extremely toxic, of course. We got it out in the 1970s, and what we now use is aromatics. The oil companies give us benzene, toluene, and xylene, which are extremely carcinogenic, and with the fine particulates cause very serious cardiopulmonary disease. So you are in is that sweet smell you smell when you're pumping your gas, it's cancer, all right? Or maybe heart attacks. What's one or the other?
I want to go to the audience for questions, but before I do that, very quickly, in response to George Shultz a moment ago, senators, he said maybe we should focus on rifle shooting small bills rather than omnibus big bills. Is that the political approach here? Is that what this is all about?
That's what this bill is that we're talking about. That's a rifle shot that says all you got to do is retrofit your new cars to make them tri-flex fuels at an affordable price.
Will it work in this political environment, do you think? Is that the...
We'll find out.
We're up on the Hill. How did it go today?
We'll find out.
Went that well, huh?
we had one very good
It went well. It went well. All right.
Okay, before we go, let's go back to leadership, and that this is not an unsolvable problem. This is an eminently solvable problem. It is simple. Let's don't complicate it. What are we going to say to the American people, not if, but when we have the next spike in oil prices, and God forbid it happens when we're trying to work our way out of this recession that we're in right now, and the effect that it has on families? Let's give families the opportunity to have choices so that when that next spike happens, the American people can see leadership and see that we have done something about this problem.
The auto companies embrace this?
They haven't yet. But I believe, and I think the Admiral hit the nail on the head there, the issue is the credits, and the credits that they need for flex fuel cars to meet the CAFE standards. If we can crack that nut, and I believe we can, then why would the automobile companies not want to produce a car that could provide the American people a choice like you have in Brazil, like you have in China, so that families, especially lower-income families, are not so terribly disadvantaged as they are today, and as was pointed out so well. Lower-income families are hit disproportionately with high fuel prices, and they are the very ones that have to drive to their jobs.
So, I've always wanted to do this. That is to sit in the seat that Alan Greenspan sat in. Now I'm irrationally exuberant, but I won't talk about it. Why don't we go to some audience questions, and we'll start with this gentleman right here.
My name is Jack Greinberg. I'm an independent oil and gas operator. I'm a multi-degreed engineer, and I have to disagree with Chairman Greenspan that the gas shale is the future of the United States. In the last year, I've drilled 41 discoveries in the Bakken referred to as shale, but it's a dolomite, and below it is a Three Forks sandstone. That's different than the Marsilio shale. We have the statistical study on the Barnett Shale, 12,000 wells at $4, it's an economic fiasco. The shale gas that the industry is now crazy about it is not gonna be the answer. $4 gas, you cannot afford to make methanol out of the shale gas that we're supposed to produce. I used to teach reservoir engineering, and you don't have the drainage that you expect to have from the Marsilio Shale. It's just not there.
Right, let me call on John and Senator and Norm to anybody else to respond to that.
Representative, the Nobel Prize winner in the back.
And the representative, the Nobel Prize winner. But first up, panel.
I think that $4 gas is not sustainable from a return on investment standpoint. But if the market for natural gas grows, supplying that market will likely impact the price of natural gas. The sweet spot for natural gas, however, is not $20 or $25 per million BTU. Sweet spot is more in the $6 to $8 range, where the return on investment is solid, and $6 to $8 natural gas being used to make methanol and coal with natural gas, or pet coke as another. There's just so many ways to make methanol that I think the solution I offer, and the reason I started Citizens for Affordable Energy, is we learned in the 20th century that if you keep the supply ahead of the demand, energy is affordable. So this to me is an opportunity to keep the supply of fuel ahead of the demand, and it will be affordable as a consequence.
Could we hear from the Nobel Prize and get your response? Can we get a microphone? Yes.
Hello, my name is Surya Prakash. I'm a professor of chemistry at University of Southern California. I collaborate with George Ola, who won a Nobel Prize in chemistry, who is promoting a concept called methanol economy for almost 20 years. Methanol, we believe, is one of the solutions to our problem in the United States, because methanol is a ubiquitous fuel which could be made from many sources. You can make it from coal cheaply. You can make it from shale gas, natural gas. You can make it from biomass by gasification, and ultimately, you can make it from recycled carbon dioxide if you have energy. So it's a good solution for our problems, and methanol, in my opinion, is the fuel which could solve our internal combustion engine issues, diesel substitutes, you can make, for example, chemical feedstocks, which you currently make out of oil and gas from methanol.
Frank. Now, what is your response to the issue of the price point, the market demand component of this? Have you looked at that in terms of the economics?
I'm a scientist, I'm not an economist, but shale gas for $4, the current price, the methanol could be produced currently in the United States for $1.10.
I've been a big believer that in terms of thinking of our energy challenges, our energy security, our economic security, our national security, there isn't a silver bullet. But there is silver buckshot. And that's what this is all about. Trying to create choice, trying to break a cartel, break a monopoly that makes choice. So while methanol is going to be one of those choices, I don't think we should hold it in such high esteem that we think that is the choice or the energy for transportation. It's one of. We've got wonderful, wonderful sources on our farms, on our ranches, and in our forests called ethanol. There's lots of misinformation about it, but that's another example of we have 10% ethanol supplying our vehicles around there. Can you imagine if we had to buy 10% more petroleum, straight petroleum every year? NASCAR is running 15% ethanol. I'm just using that as an example of the advantages of having choice. Ultimately, we've got to break the monopoly, create flex fuel vehicles, and have choice.
Let me go to this lady right here. And the mic is there. If you'd stand and introduce yourself and then have your question.
How are you? My name is Christy Rudolph, and I'd like to probably just announce myself as probably a standard working mom. I'm a single mom. I have three kids that I take care of, and I live in Fairfax, Virginia, which is not an inexpensive place to live. And I drive a Ford Expedition, which is also probably labeled as a non-green vehicle. I get approximately, I don't know, on a good day, 15 miles a gallon, which is horrible. And it's a 2004. And I would love to purchase a vehicle that would be more green and would accommodate my family of five. But I don't have the resources to do that. Although I can tell you it costs me $100 to fill my tank.
So can you direct your question to the panel?
My question is that, you know, we have all these ideas out here as to what we can do better and how we can do it better. But what do you do for the American family that is not in the non-middle class, that may be considered in the middle class or maybe upper middle class, but can't afford to necessarily purchase another vehicle that would be considered green?
All right, let's let the panel take a shot at that. Sure. Middle class.
Well, Christy, let me maybe come back to you because I'm also a family. And my daughter drives a big car because she has to, because the kids all play sports as well. Even if you don't buy a flex fuel or an open fuel standard vehicle immediately, if the market drives the cost down, the price of the fuel that you continue to purchase, the gasoline that you continue to purchase will be driven down by the competition of an open fuel standard.
Also, retrofits are not out of the question. You may find very cheap retrofits to turn existing cars into flex fuel.
We have about 5 minutes, 10 minutes left. Is that all right? I'm just looking around for some 5 minutes. All right, let's see if we can take some quick questions and quick responses, and we'll move it around. We'll come in the front, and then we'll move it around. I want to make sure we get to the sides, too. Come back.